minute, pal. Look here.
Stand by.
One for C-Lab, two for Tor Eagle, three for Mother Rain to round out the trio in this episode. Everybody dies.
Broadcasting live from inside the power band, this is The Blah. In this episode, everybody dies. I'm your host, the Mulverine, along with my intrepid companions, Head in a Jar Higo.
Hey.
And Slave 2.
Howdy.
Welcome to the show, folks. This week, we're talking about the 2024 classic, The Fall Guy, starring Ryan Gosling and Jody Moreno. High level.
And the full metal bitch herself.
The full metal bitch. Metal Storm.
This is great. Great name, great logo.
Right.
Love it.
So good.
Make it look like Metallica.
I defer high levels, man. I haven't ever even heard of the show before you guys talked about this movie, so.
Oh, my God. I feel like he should be dead for that, Ben.
I think it's the tiniest bit before my time. I'm such a little guy. Too. I'm like, Anakin ran in and fucking cut me up. You guys were running around like teenagers with your fucking braids and shit.
You're right. We were kind of like the bully kids in Star Trek, you know, with Spock and the learning yeah. bowls, you know?
Yep.
Get back in your learning bowl. You suck.
They learn in bowls. They put bowls on their heads to cut their hair. They like bowls.
I noticed that your hair is the same shape as your learning bowl. Logic dictates.
It's all bowls.
They punch you in your nuts.
It's all plumic soup all the way down.
Yep. See?
Fall Guy Show, 1981. I was one. Like, how the fuck am I expected to watch that? I was one.
All right. Well, you know what? I'll give you a pass on that death, dude.
Dude? A ding-dang, dude.
Dude.
So, yeah, I don't know. Like, I had a good time. It was fun. I shouldn't have liked the movie as much as I liked the movie because it was terrible, but I really liked it.
It was terrible?
It just, I don't know. Like, it was, yeah.
Tell me
we'll
why.
Talk about it. Nah.
Okay,
I mean,
okay. No, that's fine.
Nah.
Okay. Jar Higo, you want to go next or you want me to go?
Okay. So I did know the original show.
Nice.
I was not really expecting any kind of, faithful recreation of the show. It's clearly they're going for something different here, but, keeping the stunt guy part of it. Eschewing the bounty hunter part of it. Getting rid of what's his face? Bruce Boxleitner. What the hell was his character's name?
It looks like he was like Bruce Boxleitner's cousin or whatever. Yeah, totally.
Howie.
Yeah.
Howie.
Yes.
Douglas Barr. I've got it open.
Douglas Barr. Cool. I should have had it open too. Anyways.
Same.
This is a really fun movie. I enjoyed the shit out of it. I was tickled. I was delighted. I'm dead. It was good.
Nice.
Yeah. I think it's, there's not a ton of substance here, but there's some funny shit and some great action and some great tunes. And it's just a lot of, like, it takes a minute to get warmed up, but once it gets going, it's really fucking fun.
Yeah.
Damn right.
It does take a minute. That may be what I'm saying. It took a good 15 minutes, and then I was happy. I was doing good.
Groovy.
Groovy, baby.
Everybody's so glad you're happy. Well, then.
I'm glad that you're glad.
Okay, so I loved the movie. It really doesn't have a whole lot to do with the Fall Guy show. So... like, if we were going to harken back to, like, a rating scenario, I'd probably drop my rating down to, like, a 7 or something from, like, a 9.1 because it just didn't have anything to do with the show. Now, we've encountered other movies like that. I guess I can segue into that.
I'm going to say that might not be fair.
What do you mean? Well, hear me out first. But I want to hear what you have to say. I mean... I saw the trailer And despite the fact that it clearly didn't really have anything to do with the show, I was like, dude, I'm watching that no matter what, you know, because I like Blunt. I love Ryan Gosling, you know, like it looked like a lot of fun and it was a ton of fun. It was awesome. I loved every minute of it. I actually can't wait to watch it again because there's so many things in it in little bits and bits of detail and I just couldn't catch everything. So I want to watch it again, but it just didn't really have anything to do with the show. So I don't know. Beyond that, it was amazing, man. I loved it. It was like stunt-tastic. I'll leave it at that for now.
It was a stunt-gasm.
I'm kind of glad they didn't try to like one-to-one the show, you know? Like,
yes.
It's its own thing, which makes it easier to enjoy.
Yeah. Definitely.
If they had tried to one-to-one the show, it, you know, you would be tempted to nitpick the fuck out of it.
Yeah, and definitely.
I don't think you are here because it's just a different thing, you know. There's a hat tip there with the title and the, you know, the truck and the stunts and all that stuff, but that's kind of where it ends. I think that's fine. I'm not taking any points away for not being a faithful recreation.
And so for those of us on the show that haven't seen the show, It's a stunt dude who's a bounty hunter and drives that truck. I didn't even pick up on the brown and yellow truck. Like, fucking over my head.
Well, that's all right.
But bounty hunter kind of is the big missing piece, or were there other missing pieces?
It's brown and gold.
Sorry. I feel like I'm talking to an Irishman.
Yeah, the show was about a...
green and gold.
Yeah. The show was about a stunt guy who would, you know, collect bounties in his spare time, you know, and that was sort of what made it kind of fun. And it was
cool, you know, but it would have been hard to translate.
It was actually a very cool premise, man. And it was always kind of like, you know, Jody running down to the set, you know, and it's on a movie set. And it's like, Cole, you know, there's a uncle who's somebody's uncle has a trucking company. Truck got hijacked
again.
Which was like the plot of like every Chips episode, right? So, you know, it was cool. It was a really cool premise. And it's like, you know, to be fair and to lean into Ben's point, like, you know, it's really hard to remake that into a movie unless you're going to make like the whole thing like a kind of like a bounty hunt sort of. I don't know. I don't know how else you would do it, you know. And maybe I'm being too harsh in saying that, you know, a couple points down on a rating. I mean, the movie was totally kick-ass. Don't get me wrong, you know. I just think, like, we've seen a bunch of, it's like the Point Break remake, you know what I mean? It's like, it's a great movie. It's just not Point Break. Like, don't call it Point Break. This movie, I wouldn't quite put in the same category, you know? Like, yeah. I think it's deserving of, you know, the sort of the Fall Guy moniker and, like, the characters and all that sort of stuff. It just kind of was like Jody Colt truck.
Yeah, alternate universe adjacent. Fall Guy.
Yeah, yeah. Kind of, yeah. I mean, you know, I don't know. Ryan Gosling's great, dude. I love
him. I love Ryan Gosling.
He's just great.
So, you know? I didn't high level, and just maybe it's a useful place for your question of like what I did or didn't connect with. And I guess like the movie's a good example. I think we've talked about it quite a bit here and there of like a meta movie. Like it's obviously very self-referential. It's a movie within a movie. You know, there are scenes where they're talking about like, oh, should we change? You know, the third act is really tough. And like they're referencing the fact that they're having a hard time with the third act. And then they're like Emily Blunt's on the megaphone, like having a deep and meaningful in front of the crew. So like there's a whole bunch of like meta shit. And like, tons. I'm totally cool with that. And, you know, him and his stunt coordinator buddy, like quoting movies. It's like it's us, you know, like the movie's kind of like made for.
Yes.
For movie nerds kind of like us, you know, so it connected with me on that level for sure.
Good.
But, you know, the self-referential stuff, while intentional and while it makes perfect sense in this movie, like it just separates it from a John Wick, for example, you know, like John Wick 1 was an ode to stunts in a different way. And it's just a much higher caliber movie, no pun intended, but this is still a hell of a lot of fun. And I really like, it did take a few minutes, like Benny said, to kind of get into it. Because I kind of knew what I was in for. I knew it was going to be more Beekeeper-y than fucking whatever. And it was like super fun, dude. And like for me, you know, I was enjoying it. But when he was in the neon suit on the hallucinogens, I was just like, all right, dude, I'm totally like I'm perfectly happy to watch this for the rest of the movie. Totally. You know, like, this is really fun, and I'm fucking totally down.
Yes, that was great.
That was so great.
And maybe the last meta piece is just like, and it, clearly it was intentional, it's just how many fucking stunt sequences are just shoehorned into this thing. You know, like it's just, it's just, it's a stunt that's, spectacular, you know, like it's all, well, and it's cool.
It's stunt sequences held together by, you know, kind of a flimsy connective tissue of
like
rom-com, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Which is fine. It works great.
It worked.
And it is, let's talk about the sort of, it's a total love letter to the stunt community. I was reading.
Yeah, totally.
I might have been on Let's Make Nuggets Not Fun, but I'm not sure, saying that they've been trying to get stunt work as a category in the Academy Awards forever, apparently.
They really should have one.
And it really should. And they have not been able to do that. And the Academy Board or whoever always says, like, well, the show's long enough as it is. Yeah, but, like, you know, all the stunt people, rightfully so, are like, dude, every other technical category, technical part of movie making has a category. So, like, why not stunt making? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I like that the director, David Leitch, I think is how you pronounce his name.
I'm David Leitch. This is Lifestyles of the Stunts and Famous.
There you go. I like it. So he was a former stuntman himself. He has directed, co-directed John Wick, the original, with Chad Stahelski. And
Meta Chad.
He did Atomic Blonde, which was an excellent, excellent movie that we should probably do here. And for any of you folks at home that haven't seen that, you should definitely go out and check out Atomic Blonde with Charlize Theron and McAvoy. Really, really good stuff. So this guy was making like kind of like a love letter to the stunt men in the similar way that Hal Needham did with Hooper because of the story I just told you about the Academy Awards. So I think it's really cool that he did that, and it's great. I love that he just jammed and crammed stunts into every single corner of this movie, man, to the point where it's like, it's just overflowing with stunts. Like, it's so ridiculous. It's just great, man. It really is. And they're good, too. Like, there's some excellent stunts and some excellent action in here. Next contestant.
I have a lot of love for how much, I guess, respect has been gained in the community between the John Wicks of the world and stuff like this. Like, I'm stoked. Other than like a high five and like more, I'm down. And like, yeah, I agree they should have an Academy Award category. Like, I don't know. I mean, I don't have a lot to say about it. It's a weird and interesting profession, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I kind of liked that they dug into it a little bit here, you know? And it became part of the plot. We're like, oh, you're 3D scanning to swap out my face. And then they're like, you know, can you do it backwards? You know, it's this kind of like tongue in cheek. It's kind of, you know, Tropic Thunder-esque, but it actually does feed into the plot. And it also feeds into like how the normal stunt stuff goes. And so like, it was kind of cool. It was like a little bit of it was meta in a way where it was kind of behind the scenes of the stunt world a little bit too, which was kind of cool. But really, I just, you know, came for the stunts, I guess. I don't know. I was really just having a good time with the stunts.
Yeah, why not? What else is there, man? You know,
was there a unrequited love angle between Jodie Banks and Lee Majors, Heather Thomas and Lee Majors in the show? Was it all one of those classic will they, won't they bullshits? No.
I don't think so. Right, Ben?
Nope.
No, like not at all. Like not present. You know, she was like his. Go ahead.
Like, were they related?
Whoa. They might have been.
Shyamalan twist.
I mean, it was definitely like her and Howie were like assistants / sidekicks in the show.
Yes.
You know? But there was there might have been like, I'm sort of recalling that she might have had like a puppy love kind of thing for him. Because like, you know, Lee Majors was, at least it felt to me like he was like 40 and she was like 20 in the show.
It never stopped anybody in the 80s, my man.
Well, it never stopped. Yeah, it didn't stop something a lot like of that. People. Yeah. So I don't know, but I got this kind of puppy love thing from them.
Sure.
So, whatever.
It seemed like the Emily Blunt, Ryan Gosling kind of will they, won't they here and the whatever. It felt like it was trying to be a broader flick to get a broader audience in. And to be fair, like my sister-in-law is not a movie buff at all, but she enjoys, you know, action-y or movies, you know, or whatever. And she asked me she's like, oh, do you have a copy of this? And I was like, oh, interesting that you are even remotely interested in it. You know, I wouldn't have expected that to be the case. And it's clever if, you know, I mean, it must be a thing where they're trying to broaden the audience. And it's kind of a shame that it barely broke even, considering like his last movie, Bullet Train, like smashed it. So I kind of thought this would have done a little bit better, considering they were pushing that love angle a bit. And the fact that people like my sister-in-law was into it, you know, so.
Yeah.
I don't know. I didn't mind the love angle. It was kind of cutesy.
No, it was good. There's no problem with it, man.
I love both of them. Like, it helps a lot when you respect and really like the actors. Sometimes it's like it feels really forced or whatever. But
well, I mean, also in this, as opposed to the show, the actors are clearly the same age. You know what I mean?
Sure. Or,
you know, within 5 years. So it's a little bit different. They're kind of, you know, and we establish in the beginning that they're like a thing. You know what I mean? It's not like a, she's the assistant, like she's an aspiring director and so forth and so on. So the setup lends itself to it.
Yeah. Yeah. I kind of wish Aaron Taylor Johnson was they cast a stuntman as opposed to an actor, but
why do you say that?
I just kind of feel like it would have been very meta on top of meta, where you've got like A-list actor playing a stuntman and then a stuntman playing an A-list actor. You know?
That would have been cool to do and very clever.
Maybe a bit too clever, but I don't really know Aaron Taylor Johnson.
Sure you do, man. He played Quicksilver in the Avengers movie. He played,
when I look it up, I'm like, oh yeah. But
his main bag was the big thing that kind of brought him a lot of attention was Kick-Ass, which was an excellent movie.
I need to watch
it. And also had EBD favorite Nick Cage in it.
Yeah, man.
As well as McLovin. McLovin was in it as the villain, and he was pretty excellent, too.
Oh, yeah. And Chloe Grace Moretz.
Yes. Most excellent.
Yeah. I mean, I'll rewatch any Nick Cage movie.
Right?
He douched it up pretty well.
Yeah, that's Aaron Taylor. He definitely douched it up well. Oh, shit.
Oh, that's shit. There goes the planet.
No, I didn't even recognize him from the Craven trailer, man. That's him. I thought it was somebody else. He's so bloody. He's so jacked.
Yeah,
dude.
That looks. I'm not sure how that's going to go. It'd be like Morbius. It's Morbin time. It's
going to be another Sonyverse disaster.
Nah, I completely agree. Dude, if you'll allow the cul-de-sac, speaking of Sonyverse disasters, I saw yesterday that the fucking new. They scrapped the third Spider-Man movie, the fucking Spider-Versy Spider-Verse. They just threw it in the bin and they're starting over and it's coming out in 2027 now. Like, what the fuck?
What?
Yeah. Yeah,
oh,
totally.
Come on, no. Dude.
They threw it in the fucking bin. It was about to be dropped. Like,
I was like, I wonder what, I was thinking about our Turtles episode and this movie and I was like, I wonder when that's coming out. And there's like, yeah, Sony fucking, they're reworking the whole thing, retooling the whole thing.
Oh my God, dude.
So they're going to totally ruin it.
Fucking called it.
Well, you know what?
When they didn't finish this, when they cliffhangered the fucking second movie, I was like, this is a bad move.
Yeah.
Like, you know, shit just doesn't get made. So, like.
That's true.
Chances are this could die in production hell or, you know, something that could be a writer's strike. Anything could fucking happen.
Bullshit.
And it might take years for, like, the fucking sequel to get out. And what fucking happened? Boom. I fucking called it.
Done and dusted. You did call it. Yeah, it was a bummer, dude. I was.
It was a major bummer, dude.
Sorry to have to share that. Breaking on the show.
Well, you know, whatever. You just saved everybody that listens in advance, I guess, you know. I mean, shit, dude. That's so crappy. When I was listening to you guys do Mutant or Ninja Turtles, because I just edited it, finished it yesterday, man, I was like, psyched to watch it because you were making those comparisons to Spider-Verse, man. And then I was like, man, Spider-Verse is so great. And I was reminiscing about that and thinking about a sequel. So, yeah, that's a bummer.
Sony, bro.
I mean, the first one was great. I wasn't that crazy about the second one, to be honest.
Yeah. I feel like that might, for me at least, kind of, I might get more nostalgia for it now that it's going to get a giant turd for the third one, but who knows? It had its moments. The first one was fucking magic, though.
Yeah, the first one was totally magic, dude.
First one was magic.
But yeah, Kraven the Hunter, which is how we got here, I don't think it's going to be very good. Unfortunately.
Sonyverse disaster.
maybe we'll actually get the Nick Cage Spider-Man noir show.
Sure.
That would be great.
I'm down.
It is supposed to happen.
Oh, one can only hope.
Yeah, man. I don't know. I'm down. Like I said, anything Nick Cage, I'm in.
I'm in, bro.
Do you guys watch any of the Ted Lasso series?
No.
No, I don't have Apple TV, but I've heard it's great.
Hannah Waddingham is, I fell in love with her in that, and she's great. And this is Gail, the producer. She's just so fucking terrible. I love her.
Oh, my God. Yes, she is absolutely awful, man.
Kelly LeBrock's nerdy sister. That's how I kept thinking about her.
So does that mean neither of you are overly familiar with her as an actor then? Probably, because she hasn't done a whole lot.
No, I'm looking at her thing right now. Ted Lasso, Garfield movie, Willow, the series.
Because like, she's so lovable in Ted Lasso. Like, you absolutely love her as a human in that show. That it's great to see her just be such a on the face, tongue in cheek. She's like the Tom Cruise in Tropic Thunder kind of piss-takey villain, you know.
But she's not a shitbag in Ted Lasso. She's lovable.
Well, it's less that. I feel like the Ted Lasso context makes you love her terribleness in this a tiny bit more, you know? I don't know. Because she's clearly having a good time, you know, doing it. I don't know. She's just she seems like a really fucking awesome human in real life. And then she just, you know, had a nice huge break in Lasso. So it was cool to see her do something a little bit different.
No, she's great.
That's good, man. That's really good. I don't know. I wonder if I feel like I've seen her somewhere, but I can't quite put my finger on it. Anyway, who else? I didn't. The guy that was the sort of like the stunt leader, you know, that he was like, oh, do I got to call you boss now? You know, that guy was really funny, but I don't recall seeing him in anything before.
No, he's in all the Black Panther stuff.
All the what?
He's the big mountain king.
Yeah.
The dude that sometimes is and sometimes isn't a friend of whatever fucking stupid ass kingdom they're from.
In
Wakanda.
Oh.
So he's got quite a role. He was one of the main, you know, buddies in some of the Infinity War and Endgame-y fight sequence shit. And
he's in M'Baku, the ghost ape guy. Yeah, whatever. Okay. Yeah, cool. Yeah, he was good in that part of that movie.
Wasn't he in something that we just did?
No idea.
Yeah, don't know. No. Hannah Waddingham, you might remember her as one of the like priest ladies from that Game of Thrones when the queen has to walk naked through the streets and she spends a bunch of time with all the religious freaks.
So
that might be where you know her from. She's kind of like the Brienne of Tarth. She's like quite a huge, tall priest.
Sparrows,
lady.
Swallows, yeah, exactly. Or whatever. Yeah.
Wow. So we're back there now.
Yeah, yeah. But Winston Duke, yeah, man. Black Panther.
Yes.
So much for poor Winston Duke.
Yeah. I mean, he was great. I liked him. He was a good sidekick here. His character didn't really go anywhere, you know?
Yeah, it was kind of beat.
Like, they fought in that cool sequence, and then he's like, all right, man, see you later. And that was it. It's like, oh, okay. See you later.
Right.
Well, he helps set up the, he takes out the bearded, shaven-headed ginger bodyguard dude.
Ginge Minge.
The ginge giant? Yeah.
Yeah, takes him out.
That's true. Who that dude, I guess, was like a teacher in Australia. And he just, now he's acting. It's like, cool.
No, he's not.
Good for
Ben Knight is that guy's name.
Yeah.
Ted That's Knight.
Cool. Yeah, good for Ben Knight.
Ben.
He's the cousin of the Dark Knight.
It's always good to see a redhead get his ass kicked.
That's an insta-snipe, dude.
Yeah, you're dead,
Holy
bro.
Holy hell, that was death.
I thought you said Ted Knight. It's like, wow, that's a That's a coincidence.
That's interesting. 10 nights, old and white.
How about a fresca?
Yeah, exactly. Oh, man.
Huh? Huh?
Hmm? Hmm?
I didn't recognize Stephanie Sue as the lead daughter in Everything Everywhere. The dog walker in this, I completely missed
really?
That.
Mm.
Yeah.
I did not pick that up.
Doesn't
either.
Look anything like
Slave
my recollection too? Of her, but
hmm.
I mean, she was nominated for an Oscar for Everything Everywhere, so she's definitely doing well for herself.
Stephanie Sue? Dude, I do not recall her face from that movie. That is weird.
Maybe she was just a bit younger in Everything Everywhere or something.
Maybe. Was she the daughter that was like, I am creating the donut universe?
Yeah,
like
yeah,
that?
Yeah. She's the main baddie.
Oh, she's in Blue Eyes Samurai, which I've been meaning to watch because that looks really good.
I don't know. Unicorns, dude.
Unicorns is one of the notes I had, and I would just like to say that I loved that they had a full-size live unicorn in, like, all those scenes when he was tripping on that shit, man. I don't know what he was tripping on, but it was awesome, man. The visuals were incredible, and that fight scene was so damn good, dude.
Oh, it's very kind of like Scott Pilgrim-y.
It was. The effects of the drug sort of VFX made it even cooler, that fight scene.
Yeah. Speaking of drugs, I'm on drugs.
I am drugs.
Kev, did you catch that Kodagashi in that fight scene?
Dude. Kodagashi. I thought that was a Shionagi, bro. No?
That was a wrist throw.
Oh, I saw that one. Kev's watching it now.
There might well have been one, but as well, but I definitely caught that one. I was like, whoa, wrist throw. He like weaves him around and then he...
Oh, yes, like, yeah, yeah. Like, sorry, oh. Dude. I just went through like every basic move in my head. Sorry. Yeah. No, that's what I was doing, man. I was
there was
like
a loading bar on your screen.
Yes, accessing. Ah, Kodagaish. Yes, you're right. It was a Kodagaish, totally, 100%. I was like, oh, dude, Shionagi. Wow, I'm dead for that. That is so
yeah,
pathetic,
yeah, what the fuck,
dude.
Man?
Well, as a black belt, you'd think I'd know better, but apparently not.
You would think.
Wow. Yeah, I did notice that.
That
was
like for me.
Very, very psyched about that, man. I was like, because it was very, very obvious that that's what he was doing in that move. And it looked fantastic for the way they shot it on that corner angle there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, really cool. And just, you know, sort of general great ass kickery in that scene, man. You know, great use of slow-mo, totally warranted. Like, loved all the sparkles and the weird druggy VFX, man. It was awesome. That is a great example of a fight scene done well and a good use of slow-mo.
And the classic trope of like going into some baddie's lair and then, dude, the baddie's actually a fair bit of fun too. Like, he had such a crazy look about him.
He was, and he totally was funny. He was funny too. I really liked him.
And he nopes out once he realizes his goons aren't going to stop him. It was funny, dude.
Mm-hmm.
Like, gets in the cab and is like sitting there, like, come on, come on, come on.
You mean when he totally caves when he opens the cab door? He's like, no, 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 no.
Well, it was like just before that, though, where normally it's a foot chase through the city, but he runs outside and then just like jumps in a fucking line of cabs.
Yeah, it's a Camry, dude.
He doesn't even have the energy to run down the block.
Yeah, it was funny.
I had a lot going for it.
Yeah, all like chrome grilled out and everything, dude. That was... Who else?
Blunt. Gotta love Blunt.
Well, I mean, it's hard not to like her, man. She just kind of... I don't know. Everything this girl does is just super fantastic. And I'm a huge fan. She can do it all. She can be funny. She can full metal bitch, you know. She's not opposed to doing science fiction, man. She's just kind of...
She's rock solid in Oppenheimer.
Oh, man. Yeah, totally. You know? And just such a interesting smattering of films. Mary Poppins Returns and My Little Pony and, you know, all the way to The Huntsman and... You know, whatever, dude. She's just great, dude. I absolutely loved her in Sicario, man. I love
Sicario.
I mean, Taylor Sheridan, great movie. And she's excellent in it, dude.
Yep. 100%.
And, oh, shit. I forgot she was in Looper, too, man. She's amazing in Looper also.
Yep. No doubt.
Really, really great. So, yeah. What else to say about her? I don't know.
She was almost Black Widow.
Really?
She turned it down.
Really?
Like, I think she was cast, and then some other movie came up, and she stepped away, and Johansson got it.
Wow.
Alternate universe, Black Widow.
Don't know, man. Don't know how that would have been. Don't matter. Any damn way. I don't know. I don't recognize. There's a lot of people in here I don't recognize.
I mean, that's pretty much it from the cast side.
Mm.
Not other peeps, but.
Yeah, we have mined it.
Casting out gets a bit boring after a while. We talked about the neon suit scene. I kind of like how that one ended, you know, where he's like chasing the dude around and then he gets to the hotel and he's at the front desk, like fucked out of his face. Mm. And Jody walks up and he's like, oh, hey. You know, like, it's kind of, I like that it just abruptly changes gears there.
Yeah. And humorously so, yes.
Yeah, dude, there's a lot of humor in here, man.
Just getting a fruit really plate.
Keeps it going. Yeah. It was fucking great.
Yeah, the cards, you know, very funny.
Yeah, exactly.
Go back down, program the card.
And then just boots it in. Yeah. It's just, yeah. It's, I don't know. It's just the right amount of humor, just the right amount of overdoing it with the stunts. It just makes up for any weaknesses. It's just made up for in the enjoyment factor, you know?
Well, I mean, you know.
I think that's the whole point.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, whatever. Again, like, you know, I've described it as like a sequence of elaborate stunts held together with some, you know, flimsy connective tissue of rom-com, essentially. Mm, I mean, the comedy is solid, too.
It really is.
But like, as far as an overarching story goes, it's nothing, you know, crazy. It's pretty simple.
Nothing crazy, just, yeah. But I was about
it's
to.
It's really just it. There to like be a vehicle for all this shit to happen, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But even saying that, because I was going to say before you jumped in, Benny, was that, like, I think the story's good, man. You know, like.
It's good enough.
It's a solid enough, like, murder mystery scenario, you know, like, kind of.
Sure.
Whodunit that I was like, you know, solid story, excellent stunts, like, comedy's good, romantic comedy is good, romantic part's great. All that stuff was really, really good. Like, it's. Like, again, like I meant what I said in the beginning, like the only thing is that it doesn't really have anything to do with the show, but the rest of it is just like it's A-plus work, man, almost all the way around the board, you know?
Yeah. I maybe sighed a little bit more with Benny in the sense that it's like, I think it's A-plus execution, but it's like, I don't know, this is like the worst analogy ever, but all I'm thinking about is like.
Please.
Like if you're weaving something together, the quality of the thread can be high or low, and like. The quality of the story is low, but the way it's woven together and the comedy and the writing and the action stuff and the pacing makes it better. You know, like there isn't really much of a story, like it's a well-woven series of tropes, but it's well done. Like it's well executed, you know, so it's slightly different, you know, like, I don't know. I want to say Beekeepr has more going for it from a story kind of thing, because it's also a thinly veiled excuse for action, you know, whereas like John Wick 1, you could make an argument it's pretty basic because it's like dude gets his dog killed, but like I don't know, there's a lot more heart to that and the loss of, you know, Lady Wick, so
no question. I mean, if you're comparing heart, I don't really know if this movie has a heart in that sense, for sure,
because Benny said it, like it's a straight up rom-com core
and a murder mystery, you know, but I don't think either of those things would hold up quite so well if you didn't have all the other stuff as well.
If he wasn't a stuntman, it would be a fucking terrible movie.
I mean, it might be okay, but
maybe it's just not
again my favorite. I think if you think that's the main purpose of the movie, you're kind of missing the point. I think the point is just to be a fun romp of a bunch of stunts and action.
Definitely, dude.
And some good laughs and, you know,
And really nice to have something that's like fun and popcorny and like requires zero effort to watch or enjoy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, there just hasn't been enough of that in general in the world in the last
No, you're months, right.
You know
yeah.
what I mean? Like, it's.
And maybe that's a huge part of it.
That
here
was
too.
The
it's
exact
just
sentiment.
I saw like.
In the theater when we went to see it.
Wait.
Oh, you guys saw in the theater. Oh,
sorry. Say that again, Benny. I'm sorry.
That was the exact sentiment we had when we went to see it in the theater. Like, we left and we're like, wow, like, I haven't seen like. Just a good popcorny, like funny, you know, like action comedy kind of, you know, something that just like it just flew by and it was just great, you know, like we just had such a good time. So
and everybody's so serious and taking everything so seriously. Like I this is slightly off topic, but somewhat related. And like I caught on YouTube, I was looking for the Big Dumb Cups sketch because that really makes me chuckle. And I found like it was the opening from like a couple of weeks ago, and it was like a political opening, and like Gaffigan was the guy, and it was like, you know, Maya Rudolph and like Andy Samberg and like even Dana Carvey was in it, and they had, and what I liked about it was that they put everybody in it, you know, like except Trump, because like it didn't really fit in like the sketch they were doing, but it was like J.D. Vance and like Biden and Waltz and like all those people, dude. And it was like great that they had put them all together, because it was like, okay, you know, like everybody should be making fun of the whole thing. You know what I mean? And like, it really just kind of took a lot of the tension and the air out of it, man. And I was very happy to see that. You know what I mean? It was very like relieving, sort of in the same way that this movie was. You know what I mean? It was like, okay, everybody's not taking everything so seriously. You know what I mean? So that was that was a really good
bit
thing.
Bit of escape.
Dana Carvey should have been doing Biden the entire time.
He was doing Biden.
Fucking great.
It was
the entire time.
Oh, instead of Jim Carrey,
play him. It should have been him from the get go.
Yeah, dude.
This
I mean,
is the best. Like, it's stupid, but it catches like the spirit of it. You know,
I think it does too, man. Like, I gotta say, like, you know, I love Jim Carrey, dude, and I liked how he did this sort of Fire Marshal Bill Biden. You know?
Sure, like, yeah, no, it was
it
good,
was but funny like, as hell, dude. But you know, I agree. Like Carvey just.
Carvey
with the
does,
fucking ice like, cream, dude.
He doesn't do great impersonations, but he's really good at getting the spirit of it and bringing something of his own to it. And that just really cracked me up. I thought Gaffigan was great as Tim Walz too.
He was great, yeah. And the and that Asian kid, I can't remember what his name is, he's really good as JD too. They all were good, man.
Bowen Yang.
Yeah, Owen Yang and, you know, Samberg with the snack tray. Like, it was just funny as shit, dude. It was really, really great to see something like that. You know what I mean? Where it was like, let's take them all, throw them in a blender and, like, make fun of them. It was great.
Sure.
So similar kind of thing to this movie, man. You know, it's just like, you watch it and you're like, movies aren't dead after all. Like, here's, like, a nice, fun, stupid kind of movie, you know, that's just about, like, blowing shit up and like let's make a love letter to stunt guys, you know, just great, dude.
It's just pure
I feel
fun.
Like this is the
there's no
sorry,
fucking it's just pure fun. There's no space Hitler or you know
for nonsense.
Exactly. Yeah, I was just gonna say the same thing. Like, it's not a fucking Marvel Universe movie. Like, this is kind of what a fun blockbuster was before the
billion-dollar
franchise wars, you
know
what I mean?
I know. Yeah. I agree with you, man.
Yeah.
I love that idea, like the mega franchise wars. Your father fought in the mega franchise
Your
wars.
Your father fought at the franchise wars. I mean, you know, before, I mean, I got to say, like, Fast and the Furious didn't start as a mega franchise. You know
the first
I mean?
One, I love that one, man.
And even, like, I'm a big fan of the third one, too, man. And, like, those first couple were, like, those were just fun, like, octane movies with, like, dumb sort of plots. And it was just like, let's go. Fucking race cool cars around, man. Like, those were fun, you know? Once we got to, like, jumping off satellites to Dubai, like, then it got a little retarded. But, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever. Yeah.
So, you see, Vin Diesel was your father. From a certain perspective.
From a certain point of view.
Vin Diesel could be my father anytime.
Well, the funny thing about that is that in Tokyo Drift, like, the main guy that Sean Boswell hooks up with.
In Fast and the Furious Tokyo Drift.
In Fast and Furious Tokyo Drift, Sean Boswell hooks up with a character whose name is Han Solo. He's Korean, though. No, really, that's the guy's name, dude. It was like kind of like like a super cheeky nod to Star Wars, but so in that sense, it is
Chicken Kev, Fast and the Furious historian,
right?
In addition to my doctorate in Mortal Kombat lore, I also I can't even do it.
I think your name it should be like Topic Drift. You know, like the amount of times you go off topic.
Hang on 1 second, man. Let me change my. I wish the audience could see these.
That's Chicken Kev, Topic Drift.
No, the topic drifter.
So good.
Talk about off topic, dude. I saw this fucking stupidest video the other day. I'm sorry, I gotta share this.
Prove the point, bro. Prove the point.
Come on. I am gonna prove the point. So I saw this stupid video the other day. It was just like a bunch of like Harley dudes like rolling into a spot. This dude dubbed all these dubbed himself saying brother like 300 times. Every time one rolled in, he'd go brother, 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 because all those dudes, that's all they say, dude. Yo, brother.
I love it. Snap into a slim gym.
Fucking Sturgis. Fucking
totally
20,000 lone wolf, you know, one of a kind. You know, rebel renegades, all wearing
the same
made in Taiwan leather vests,
beards and bandanas and cut off jean jackets. And
it's pretty great.
All riding varying degrees of Harley Davidson. But yes. Hey, man, they're one of a kind.
They're all one percenters, brother. I don't think.
Is the irony of not lost on guys like that?
Yeah,
I don't know. And one can only hope, man.
I don't run with a pack, you know.
Yeah,
I run solo.
I'm a lone wolf. I ride a Harley Davidson with all my brothers that have Harley Davidsons, and their brothers, and their brothers' brothers, and their brothers' 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 brothers.
I'm in a motorcycle club. We call the Brothers.
we should start a motorcycle gang, get leather jackets. It just says called Venture Brothers on the back.
Yeah, but you got to spell it Brutther instead.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Totally.
And now I'm going to have to cut that out because, you know, there's
with
probably
two Slim Jims, like a probably, Slim Jim cross.
Yes. There's probably like a.
Why are you gonna have to cut that out? You don't want to piss off the bikies.
Dude, yeah, there's like a. I'm sure there's one biker that listens to this show, and he's gonna hear Jarhigo doing that. And be like, bro, brothers, we gotta roll. This dude's talking shit about
shouldn't
us.
Make fun of me like that, brother.
Down. They're gonna ride their bikes.
Good luck riding
the
your fucking Harley across fucking Nantucket Sound, bitch.
They will. They can because their bikes are enchanted. Dude,
give me a boat ticket, brother.
For all they have to do is I'll be waiting. They do the brother incantation, dude, and then their bikes can drive on the water, bro.
Yeah.
They have biker Merlin cast
totally
the charm of making so they can
Dude. Or the what was the little
biker
thing
from, grain.
What was that cool little thing from Dungeons
Anal
and Dragons? Nafrach,
ut vas bethod. Dochiel the Envy.
There you go. Wow, you know, dude, that was the nerdiest shit I've heard in a while. Nice job. What was the little thing they had in Dungeons and Dragons that would get them from here to there? Was it called like the hither dither or something like that?
Yeah, the portal gun.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah.
Yeah. That was a fucking good movie.
Yeah, it was a really good movie.
That was.
But what was it called? It was called the Hither Dither, right? Or something like
hither,
that?
Hither, Tither, Hither.
Hither, Thither.
Hither, Thither.
It was called the Hither Locklear, I think.
Yes.
No, it was the Hither Thomas.
Oh, those, both of
hither,
those.
Hither, Tither.
Those were both terrible and death-worthy. Goodbye.
Go fuck yourself, Kev.
Fuck you.
Well, Hither Locklear was not in The Fall Guy.
No, that's true.
It was...
You're trying to bring it back to the movie.
I know.
Come on,
you're trying.
Yeah, I know that. It's not redeeming your death, but it is bringing us back on topic, bro.
Topic Thunder over here is having a hard time beating it.
Topic Thunder, holy shit! I love it.
I love it, baby.
Nice work, well done, brothers.
Brother,
I'm trying to imagine what like a biker Gandalf would look like, dude.
Biker Gandalf.
Merlin. Well, the same way.
He would do what?
No, he would have a braided beard, and he'd have like really greasy, greased back hair.
He would still have that like chrome, like you know, skullet helmet there, and
yes, but with some sort of pointy, wizardy kind of thing maybe on it, and he would definitely
and he'd have some like stupid fucking thing to stick his staff into on the side of the bike, you know, so like rides along with him.
Well, I would still have the big staff, you know.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah, exactly.
I think. Like with like
fire
a Bic
stogies with it,
a Bic lighter like tape. How about a Bic lighter like tape to the top, man? Wouldn't that do it?
Yeah,
and I think he would, Ben. You know, tell me what you think about this. He in my vision of like a biker Merlin would be riding the three bike stupid chariot bike from Furiosa, hey, man. Right?
Yeah. I don't think Ben's gonna be on that motorcycle, but maybe.
I think maybe he would be in the sidecar of a motorcycle that just drives itself.
There you go.
He just kind of sits back in the sidecar while the motorcycle drives with his arms crossed.
I like that even better.
Well, if he's going to be sitting in a sidecar, he should be played by Sean Connery because Sean Connery looks good in a sidecar.
He does.
Junior.
Yes.
Maybe we should do that one next, dude. I want to. Yeah, I love that movie.
What, an indie movie? Or that
dude,
indie
Last
movie?
Crusade.
That is so good.
Wait, what? Zardoz Revisited? Yes.
Yes.
Dude, we definitely need to...
correction.
I definitely think that we need to start doing some revisits at some point.
Do you?
Yeah. I think it would be fun to do, you know? Be a fun romp. Clearly, nobody likes that idea. Okay, moving right along. What was the movie we were doing, folks? Oh, Fall Guy, right.
The Fall Guy.
Anyway, bits and bobs. Go ahead.
Yeah, I think we're bitsing and bobsing. Like, the only thing left to talk about is the action.
Take a look at me now. There's just an empty space. That was
so good, dude.
That was my favorite bit. The dump truck fight. The little French dog.
Yeah, do you guys have dumpsters like that in the States? Because
no, but I read about what they mean. No. Yeah.
The skip bins, yeah.
No.
They're driving around all over town here, man.
But the long drop apparently is like some deep hole used for defecating.
Yeah, yeah.
And
it's
urinating.
It's a dunny, bro. It's a toilet. It's just an outhouse.
It's cool.
So nothing else about that scene. Just the dunnies and the long drops and the
there's a hell of a lot to it. They really, really went for the skip bin thing.
It was a really excellent fight scene too, man.
I love the amount of like it's not parkouring around he did, but like just getting from vehicle to ladder jumping. In the penthouse or jumping over across the skip.
A lot of,
I was really into that. Yeah.
A lot of like classic sort of stunt jump falling.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. I really dug totally. That. Yeah,
and you got to get dragged behind the car for a minute, and you got to have used something as a fucking skateboard on a bridge somewhere, and it was Sydney fucking Bridge, which is kind of cool. So
totally,
yeah, totally.
I did really enjoy the Sydney setting. I thought that was cool.
That was cool. Yeah.
I also, just to go back to Benny's bit, I really enjoyed that scene, man. It was a really, I don't know, it was funny because like I felt like everything else in the movie kind of overshadowed what was going on in the karaoke scene, but I thought the karaoke scene was pretty brilliant, man. It was like really funny, and all the actors were doing a really good job of sounding like shitty people that don't know how to sing. You know what I mean? And it really just made it great. I liked it. And I liked that song, so it was good. Really good.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
Against all odds.
Yes.
And then, good. The fight scene
good bit
juxtaposed with the karaoke club.
Very good.
Good well, bit it's it's clearly intentional, but I like how you almost care less about the fight sequence and care more about whether he gets to see her in time, you know, in the classic rom-com-y bullshit fest, you know?
Yeah, 100%. One of my favorite things in this movie is that I Was Made for Loving You by Kiss is like the theme music for the whole freaking movie, dude. Like,
It's the score. Yeah.
It is the score, exactly. So we get, you know, obviously the actual song used in all different varieties. And then we get it as, you know, score as well. And I absolutely loved it. I thought it was fantastic. In addition to that, well, I'll save this for my next go. Go ahead, next person. Next contestant.
I'm not sure why, but I was pleased by that.
Yes. That was fun. It's because the song's kick-ass. Anybody? Bit and or Bob?
I'm looking for the bush painting.
You just stole that from me, so.
Oh,
I stole what? The I was made for loving you thing?
Yeah, that was the thing I was going to bring up next.
Sorry, dude.
Hey, fair game, man.
We should have had like a little...
What do we call it? A snipe?
Yeah, we used to call it a snipe, yeah.
Yeah, that was a proper snipe.
Bit right snipe.
There. Well done, sir.
Thank you. We should have had like a little pregame in the green room, man.
All right, I'm going to talk about this bit. I'm going to talk about that bit.
Oh, no. Come on.
Kev. Come on. I think, all right, I'm going to throw another one out there. I loved that they threw in the Bionic Man sound.
Yes.
Like 3 or 4 times when he was making moves, dude, usually in slow-mo. It was freaking awesome, dude.
Yeah, there was definitely one where, you know, the tomahawk scene there, like the Last of the Mohegan scene when they're in Douchebag's apartment and the ginger dude busts in, they're like fighting. There's definitely a whatever, however you want to do it.
Tune in next week for 1 hour of Kevin Jarhego doing weird noises.
No, it's more like no,
totally. I wonder, you know what I would love to know actually is what that sound is made of.
Who's still listening?
For all the listeners that are still, whoa.
Whoa. Did you answer your own question on the internet or something? You stopped talking halfway through a sentence.
I did. What was this? What did I say? What happened?
I don't know.
No, I'm looking for the fuck. I hear Jarhego playing it.
Oh, he's going for it,
dude. That's deep, bro.
I remember that. I remember that song.
It sounds like just an organ with a lot of delay on it. That's what it sounds like.
Right? It doesn't
like a funky 60s Monkees organ or like the organ, yeah, from like the Munsters theme, you know, like that same kind of sound, but like just like a weird discordant chord, but with a bunch of echo on it. So I don't know. I might be wrong.
Bionic strength sound effect. Here we go. Remastered. Bro, you put too much bass on that. What? What's so funny?
Kevin Mower, sound effect audio file.
Kevin Mower. Is there a place that I could leave a 1-star review for sound effect?
I'm going to comment on this particular video. Too much bass, bro. Sorry, brother.
Brother.
Hey, brother. Put too much bass on that Bionic Man sound.
Hey, bro.
Ooh, apparently the U.S. Army is building a real Iron Man suit.
Oh, man. Get me away from YouTube. Okay, other topic bits and drift. Bobs. Other bits and bobs. The topic drifter. All right, other bits and bobs. Go.
Boat chase, dude. Miami Vice jacket. Boat chase.
Dude.
Miami Vice song.
So good.
Miami's tied behind his back.
Sailboat.
Yes.
Yeah, dude. Boat jumps, dude. It's pretty sick. Still going.
Still going. Topic drifter. Boat jumps are great, man. I mean, there's nothing like boats on fire jumping into stuff. And there was some seriously large gasoline explosions in this, too, that were awesome, man.
There's definitely a gasoline flight accident or two.
There's nothing like a gasoline explosion.
What other action sequences were there?
Dude, there's too many to count, man. It's almost
too many.
I found like I couldn't keep track of them all because there was too many. It's like and they all bleed together. And then, like, even in, like, the simplest scene, you'll have some kind of stunt or action happening somewhere in it, in the background or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Like, even when he goes over to the guy's house, you know, it's like all of a sudden some girl runs out with, like, a crappy prop katana and starts cutting the shit out of
everything. Yeah, I like that. It reminded me of
fun.
Like,
I liked
it. It was great. I'm not
reminded me of, like, a Pink Panther Kato fight. You
it
know?
Did.
Like, sure,
yes.
Sure.
Dude, those fights were great, man.
Those fights are the best.
Oh, God, they were so good. So ridiculous. What else?
Retrieving the douchebag's car, like, when he's...
Oh, yeah, the fucking valet.
Oh, valet, dude, yeah. The valet section was great.
The douchebag was such a great douchebag, too. Oh, I worked with him on a movie, man.
He was such a bro.
Just, like, so punchable. Such is a crisp fiber in it if there's no scratches?
I saw crisp that. Fiber. I was like, dude, the whoa. Crisp fiber. Whoa, watch out.
Sweet. I was almost out of toilet paper.
Oh, God. I love when he came screaming around the corner in the car. He's like, my car!
It's a rental.
Is that what it was? A rental?
That's what he said. Yeah, nice. He said, dude, it's a rental. Yeah, it was great. It was very Ferris Bueller.
People doing stupid things.
Very Ferris Bueller.
let me see here. Other bits and bobs. I just really loved the end scene, man. Like that helicopter, like the bar fight when he was on drugs was great. And then the helicopter.
Fucking helicopter.
The helicopter fight was fantastic. It was like, it had
and
some
terrible,
kinda,
but. Which made it more fantastic.
Well, like, terrible, I don't know in what sense you mean that, but, like, terrible. I really...
I mean, in the helicopter hovering 10 feet over the ground for 45 minutes. Like,
well,
it was
sure.
Totally fine. I'm totally
okay,
fine.
Okay, fine. But
that's what
I
makes
liked
the
it.
Be fun, you know? Like,
exactly. Yeah, like, yeah, yeah.
It's
exactly.
Harkening I thought it, back to all those really unrealistic...
Exactly. 18
you know,
kind of shit.
Action
yeah.
sequences, yeah.
Well, I loved when he was hanging from, like, the struts of the helicopter and he, like, swung...
You don't see a lot of that anymore.
When he swung from one strut to the other, I was
yeah,
like,
that
yes.
was
nice, right? And then the other thing too was like it had like really? Elements of like a silly kind of goofy Jackie Chan fight that you would see in like a Jackie
sure.
Chan movie, you know. Yeah. And I really like that with just like you know all the stuff in the seat and the tape and the gun, you know. And I just love the way it ended too, when they finally positioned the bag underneath him, you know, and he's like, "Gail, it's empty."
Yes,
so great way to end it. And you know, shout out to always shout out to Momoa, dude, just love
oh
it.
Oh my
right?
God, dude, that was
so
perfect.
Good. And like
it was the most Momoa squared thing ever,
right? And did you guys catch
speaking of Harley Bros, Jesus,
oh my
right?
God,
oh
right?
My fuck, that was so perfect.
It was so great. And then did you guys catch, like, when they were, like, I mean, firstly, Metal Storm was just, like, the stupidest name, greatest stupid science fiction movie, like, ever. It was, like, I want to see that movie. It was so, like, stupid looking.
Yeah.
Man. And it
there
was,
is that. That is a movie.
What?
Did you see that? There is a movie called Metal Storm that's
no.
basically about that. It was made in, like, the 80s or some shit. And it's calling directly out to. We should totally fucking do that sometime.
Oh, yeah. Well. Calling directly out to it, dude. The title of the movie in this was Metal Storm 2.
Well, there you go. Hang on, I gotta look. I didn't actually look it
yeah,
up. But
wow, I'm getting a lot of.
I saw that it was. It
getting
was an
a lot
actual
of distortion
movie.
On you, man.
I definitely remember seeing that in the video store.
Really?
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
I never watched it.
1983, Metal Storm,
on
the destruction
desert planet,
of Jared
Warlord
Sin.
Warlord Jared Sin is trying to convince a tribe of mutants that he's their messiah and
oh,
gain power.
Ow, dude, this guy
crystal.
Is. Brilliant, man. I didn't even know that. I didn't realize it was an actual movie, man. It kind of had like vibe to me. It had vibes of like, what the hell was the name of that stupid movie? There were like 15 sequels in Tropic Thunder that they had all the trailers for at the beginning.
Uh-oh.
Ben Stiller in, you know, like the whatever it was, Atomizer or whatever. I can't remember what it was called, dude. Oh,
yeah, I definitely remember seeing this terrible. Movie poster or this,
God, this
videotape so, cover.
Oh, that looks terrible, dude. Holy moly.
I'm down. Let's do it.
Dude, let's put we this on the it. List. Yeah, we should totally do this.
It
probably
it
is
looks
it
like
probably
it's
not
right
available
stuff.
Anywhere. Oh, wait, is this rent on Amazon? Wow. How about that? Oh, it even says at the top, it's high noon at the end of the universe. Wow. Awesome. 3D, yeah, too. Exactly. God.
83D. It made $5 million at the box office. So it was clearly a very, it was like a mega bomb. I love that, though, because it looks like they made it like the cheesiest, stupidest, actioniest, marveliest movie. And then it turns out it's based on an actual fucking movie.
But let's go deeper. There's got to be some more to this, dude. I'll bet the director like worked on this movie or some weird shit like that.
Something. But there's another layer of meta, you know. You have a movie about making movies, and then the movie that they're making in it is an actual reboot. So this is a reboot of
an 80s Fall Guy, movie.
And then they're making a reboot show, of Metal Storm. You know, this is really, I love it.
Oh, it's really God. Fun. Wow, that's brilliant, dude. Really, really brilliant. Pretty excellent.
I just want to throw it out there that I feel like they did a better job with the meta in this movie than, per se, the...
actual?
No, just the, like... whatever the last Matrix movie was, like,
oh my god, yeah,
they did, yeah.
That type of thing would typically annoy me, but it didn't bother me at all in this. They handled it well.
I agree, it was handled really well. Oh my god, Kelly Preston and Richard Mall are in this terrible movie. Holy hell.
Oh my god,
it's not available
anywhere. Topic drift.
To be fair, I did not drift
to buy
this
it on
year.
Like Blu-ray.
I'm not buying this.
I'm sure we can find a truck somewhere that has one.
Yeah, that's true.
Just back to Momoa, dude. Like, I thought that they were going to go the obvious route here where convince Focus Trinity. Sorry, they convince Tom Ryder to...
Focus Tiffany.
Exactly. They get Tom Ryder to admit that he actually did murder the other dude. And as a result, he's no longer a star. And Colt Seavers becomes the star of the movie. And then he becomes an A-lister. He goes from stuntman to being a movie star. And I'm glad that they just like shoehorned Momoa into it. It was just fucking hilarious,
man. It was. It was really, really good. Really well done.
And he was so over the top Momoa. I don't know. Even that was meta, you know, where everyone considered, or we consider Momoa over the top, and then he over the tops is over the top. He drives the truck through the fucking front of the house and takes his kid back. Like, he's so fucking Momoa'd out.
Totally, dude.
What are you fucking reading?
I didn't realize Kelly Preston died, dude, in 2020. This is weird.
Okay.
And also, I had mentally footnoted, dude, that we just lost John Amos, dude. Like a week or two ago, yeah. It's a bummer.
Oh, man.
It was another famous actor, too, and I can't recall the name.
Mr. McDowell.
Yeah.
God damn it, man.
I know.
Best, most bizarre role ever was him in Beastmaster.
Dude.
Yeah, dude. You thinking Christopherson or James Earl Jones?
Both.
Kev? Yeah, both, obviously, but. Maggie Smith as well.
Oh, wait. No, I thought we mentioned that James Earl Jones passed away. And would you say Christopherson died? Really?
Yeah.
I think Maggie Smith was the other one that I saw that was very recent. Yeah, that's a bummer, dude. Damn.
We're losing them all, dude.
Christopherson was, I always thought of him more of like a country singer, but he was a pretty good actor, man. And he definitely had
a... Yeah, he had his moment.
I'll tell you what was great about him, dude, is very, like... Not as much as Sam Elliott, but dude, was he ever crusty. He was crusty in everything. He had a nice layer of crust on him.
Total nerf herder.
He was crusty. Right?
Yeah, definitely a crusty dude.
He was a scruffy looking nerf herder.
He was a nerf herder, bro.
No doubt.
Who's scruffy looking? Bro, it's a compliment.
I'm going to volunteer for a death because I actually thought it was crusty nerf herder, so I'm gonna volunteer for a death.
Holy
there.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
You're dead, honey.
Dude.
What?
Yeah, sorry. Taking away my Star Wars card now.
And a Star Wars death, dude.
Right?
And wow.
And I want to keep it meta, you know?
Keeping it meta. Slave 2 stepped in it hard.
Yeah, you stepped it. You've used the word meta.
Every time we say meta, do a shot. Geopolitics.
Chad just racked up 3 deaths in like 1 second.
I don't know. How did you feel about the geopolitical stuff?
Way into it. It was also kind of like, if we're, you know, if we're still talking about this movie, I don't even know.
Sure.
I like that it was setting the movie. You kind of feel like there's some weird underworldy bullshit going on with why the fuck, you know, Tom Ryder's gone and what the mystery is in terms of, and it turns out he just like fucking kicked a dude and he broke his neck on a table partying. You know, I kind of love that it's just a cover up of a murder as opposed to some huge underworld bullshit fest.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a cover up of involuntary manslaughter.
Yeah, exactly. Like it's not even like, yeah. That's so funny, man. I don't know. I like it. I like how low stakes it actually turns out to be. And then they just really dial it up. Yeah. Because so often it is a space Hitler situation, to Benny's earlier point. So often it is that John Wick, there is a fucking high table, the whole world is looking at you bullshit. But this is just some fucking Tom Cruise wannabe. I also like that they call out Tom Cruise in the movie. So they're like, oh yeah, Tom Ryder, he's a fucking idiot. And you're like, oh, they must be like piss-taking Tom Cruise. And then later they're like, we should get Tom Cruise here. Like, oh, okay. They're obviously throwing that in there to not piss off Tom Cruise. You
know? Yeah. What else? Bits and bobs.
I don't think I have any other, man.
I don't. I'm out.
I'm out.
I'm out. All right. We're moving on. MDR. NDR.
Arr. Skarsgar.
I think I dropped every good nugget that I had.
Hang on. There was one, I think.
A couple of decent ones, but a lot of fluff, dude. I'm going to go ahead and rate the let's make nuggets not fun section is getting a F this week.
Okay.
I have a nugget.
Oh, yes, Benny. I love it.
Do it.
It has nothing to do with this movie, though.
That's fine.
We even better.
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you know that the original title for John Wick was Scorn?
Yeah, yeah.
And that it only became known as John Wick because that's how Keanu was referring to it on his like press tour.
Yeah.
He kept calling it the John Wick movie, so I just decided to change the name to John Wick.
Yeah, I just read that the other day, man. That's so weird. Yeah, that's a really good one.
That's great. I did not know that.
So, there you go. Hey, not this movie nugget.
This isn't a nugget, but this is a nuggety bob where, like, I really appreciated how many call-outs there were to other movies. Like, the obvious stuff, like quoting movies to each other, and then, like, the... Mm-hmm. The Death from Above helmet, which is a call out to Apocalypse. All those little movie lover nuggets, man. I was so into that.
I like that too, man.
So into that.
I will say this is really more for the bits and bobs, but I'll throw it out there now.
Nuggety bob, brah.
Because they put it in the...
We already did bits and bobs, didn't we?
Yeah, we did. So, all right, whatever. It's a nuggety bob. Shout out to Nuggety Bob. And when Aaron Taylor Johnson does that... Matt McConaughey impersonation. Did you catch that?
Oh, hell yeah, dude.
Right?
Hell yeah.
I've been killing aliens long before anybody paid me to. Great stuff.
Yeah, dude. Total take your shirt off moment.
And a solid impression.
He was channeling McConaughey for that role for like...
Quite a bit. Yeah.
For the role within the role, yeah.
Yeah.
That whole speech at the end there was very McConaughey.
It was good.
The one nug that I think is in that list that I give two shits about is the one that says that Gosling ran into Spielberg and Spielberg said that he liked the movie. And Gosling's like, I don't give a fuck what anyone else thinks. Like, cool. I like that someone like a Spielberg would appreciate the movie within a moviness and the fact that it's not fucking Shakespeare. Like, because he gets that it's, you know, a stunt spectacular and it's fun. And it's exactly what it was.
So yeah,
high fives to the Berg.
I guess I'll rate that nugget a C because it's fucking stupid.
Whatever, man.
No, it's a cool tidbit. No, I get it. It's a cool tidbit, but it's like it's not really a nugget. It's just kind of like Ryan Gosling.
All right, well, tidbits with C-Lab then. There's my fucking tidbit.
Shut up, dude.
It's my cereal. Tidbits,
dude. It's not you. It's the stupid. Let's make nuggets not fun. Here we are, not
my cereal
fun,
is called Tidbits, and when you reach in and pull out the prize, it's just a middle finger that comes out of the box.
That is so you, dude. Oh my god! Right?
Wait, I'm on a fucking nuggety gripe where I cannot fucking believe that zero cereals have prizes anymore. What the fuck is going on?
Yeah, it's bad.
When did that change?
No idea. A while ago, dude. Well, why give free prizes when you can just get the kids hooked on
the
sugar?
We need to make our own.
It was the best.
We need to make our own, like, you know, magic spoon healthy cereal.
Yeah, but it's going to have prizes in it.
It's going to have fucking prizes in it.
Definitely.
Right?
And there will be EBD specific prizes, you know?
What the fuck did that change?
I wish we could
change a long ass time ago, but it's
why don't we make those? Let's make those commandos that we're always
going
on about, right? Dude,
commandos.
Yeah. With a prize. And what would the prize?
Quite a few cereals.
Prize? Set of brass knuckles, dude. Why is the box so heavy, Mom? There's a set of brass knuckles in every box, son.
Must be 21 years old.
Yes.
Or older to purchase.
You need an ID to buy cereal. Deadly weapons inside. That's right, kids. A free prize. A set of brass knuckles. All right, let's wrap this up since we're all staring at the internet or whatever the hell we're doing. Or whatever Chad's doing. I can't see what Ben's doing, but...
No, I'm just seeing that... I don't know if it's true because it's on the internet, but it's saying that laws changed about how you could, like, entice children to buy stuff, and so they couldn't put toys inside anymore, which makes me even fucking more mad.
Dude, it makes
toys deck and cereal. I'm going to die on that hill.
They're making all the food. It's so addictive now, dude. It's like, you're griping about prizes? Give me a break.
Give me a fucking break.
All right.
Recommendations? Fucking watch this movie, dude.
The same reason we don't have Saturday morning cartoons anymore, basically.
Thank you.
Bullshit, man.
Exactly,
dude. I mean, you know.
It's the parents' fucking job to parent. God damn it.
And then Chad's going to be like, all right, I got to go. I got to take my kid to like Halloween slasher 5.
Yeah, exactly. I'm going to be that douchebag that dies on the hill where I'm going to buy cereal and like open it up and put a toy inside and close it back up and just like convince my kids that it's a thing.
Yeah, I like that.
While watching Halloween slasher 5.
You're going to do like the obvious plant thing, but with cereal.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Yes. Everybody's recommendation is go see the
recommendations.
Movie.
Recommendations. Watch this fucking
go
movie.
Go see the movie. What are we doing next week?
Don't be a dick about it. It's fun.
Fun.
Peacock, brother. You can watch it on Peacock.
Brother. What can we watch on Peacock?
Brother.
Peacock.
You can watch my Peacock, brother.
Watch my peacock, brother.
You can watch my cock pee.
Whoa,
brother.
Whoa.
Hey, been to water sports, brother. Sturgis, brother.
Pee, brother. it's so bad. God, that is like a nuclear three-way death right there. It's so shitty. It is. That was terrible. Speaking of deaths, how about a nuclear three-way death?
Speaking of people, brother.
Speaking of that, we did not do the death section.
We're too busy talking about water sports, brother.
We're too busy talking about brothers. All right.
Hey, brother.
Okay, so death section. Very excited about this. Really great death showing this week. I'm super stoked about it.
Brother. We're going to call this brother death section, brother.
All right. Ben started kicked us off with a delightful.
This one's
dead.
For the edit, Kev. Ready? Brother. Snap into it.
Oh, yeah.
That is going to be the new Benny Snap, bro. You just nailed it, son. Nice job. All right. So, Benny, we had a lot of deaths this week. Probably the most we've had in a long while as I do a quick scroll. Benny started us with a delightfully dead. And then I had the... Ben Knight is the cousin of the Dark Knight death, which was
so dumb.
I also had the it was Kodagaish, not Shionagi death, which I should have known. Benny had then the Hither Thomas death. And then Chad had the Hither Locklear death. Oh my god. And then Chad with a forfer, man. Then he had the crusty Nerf Herder death, then the Star Wars death that entailed, and then the too much meta death. Because you said meta like 3,000 times in this episode.
Bullshit.
You're like, ooh, this is meta. Hey, Jarhigo and Kev, this is meta too. Look how much meta is in this meta.
That it was meta.
Did you know how much meta is inside this meta
movie?
Nice Randy Savage. Goo yeah, ooh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Ooh, brother.
Because I'm not going to remember to do this and put it as chapter art, it's a photo of Macho Man standing in front of a Goodyear sign at night where only the OO in good and YEA in year. So it says, ooh, yeah.
Ooh, yeah, brother.
That makes the joke funnier. Explaining it makes the joke funnier.
Yeah.
It does.
Let's explain it.
It's a hard one. It's a visual joke. And
visual joke. I'll try to remember to stick it in the show notes.
Put it in the chat, Daryl. Chad.
I applaud your attempt to describe it.
I do have the most not fucking relevant to the conversation, Anik Nugget.
It's like this entire episode, dude, so don't stop now.
But I went, don't stop me now. I went camping with the little dude on the weekend, and there was a suspension bridge over like a river, like a little shitty little bridge. And it had these big steel cables. And I was like, oh, yeah, that's holding the bridge up, whatever. I was like, check this out. And I hit the fucking cable with a rock, and it made the blaster sound from Star Wars. I was like, that's how they made the sound for the movie. And he was like, it was really cool.
That was a great little
Star Wars-y moment. It was really fucking great.
That's a nerd and a nerdling having a moment.
He stood there for like 5 minutes just shooting blasters. You know, it was great. It was super cool.
Pew, 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 pew.
Completely irrelevant, but there you go.
Loved it. Okay, what are we doing next week, Slave 2?
I don't know. Yeah, whatever. Indie? Fucking, I don't give a shit. What do you want to do? Topics.
Yeah, I don't know. Indie, I don't give a shit. There you have it, folks.
What do you want to do?
I don't know. You want to do Indie 3? Let's do Indie 3.
I don't mind.
Jardage Commandant.
The things that we had randomly kicking around. It Takes Two? Is that the Gutenberg one?
Oh yeah, the one where Gutenberg gets over his cancer treatment and he's in love with his
All right, cool. Give me another one, Kev.
Slave 2. What are we doing next week?
Well, considering that we shat all over comic book movies, we're gonna do the new Deadpool movie.
Ooh, that sounds fun.
Which also kind of shits all over comic book movies, so it kind of works, but it's a comic book movie.
And I know Jar Higo's down. So there you have it, folks.
Old Jar Higo.
Old Higo. What do you mean, old Ben Higo? Hey. Oh.
Hey.
Hey, look at those bazooms. Hey.
He's just a crazy old wizard.
Hey. Look at them bazooms. Hey,
look at them bazooms. Hey.
Barsooms. Whoa.
Dude, Bard is suing me, dude.
You got legendary a double shit. Bogey at 3 o'clock.
Bard is suing me should be on a fucking t-shirt.
Well, we need to start making t-shirts, so we'll put it on the list. All right, folks, thanks for joining us for the Fall Guy, and we'll see you next week for Deadpool versus Wolverine.
Hey.
And that's it. This is all of us here at the EBD podcast saying so long for now, folks. We'll see you next week.
Bye.
Toodles.
And that's going to wrap up this week's episode, folks. If you'd like to check out the show notes, you can do so in your podcast app, choice, or our website, ebd.fm/episodes/278. For all of you people out there that have supported us all of these years, we really appreciate it from the bottom of our heart. Thank you so much. It's really kept us going and at times literally kept the show going. So thank you so much. And for all of the folks out there that would like to contribute, you can support us directly on Patreon with actual money if you like. You can also tell people to check out the show, which is great. And you can rate us and review us, which is a really powerful way to help us out. You know, algorithms and so forth. Not this algorithm, but those algorithms.
Huh? Not me.
And yeah, that's about it. If you want to catch us on social, check out Instagram. That's where we lurk. And that's it. Thanks for joining us for Fall Guy. We'll see you next week for Deadpool versus Wolverine. So long for now, folks.
So everybody dies.
Brother, brother, brother.
Stop into it.
Tonight, I'm gonna have myself a real good time. I feel alive. Next time.
me now. Don't stop me, 'cause I'm having a good time, having a good time. I'm a shooting star leaping through the sky like a tiger, defying the laws of gravity. I'm a racing car passing by.
Good time, I'm having a ball. Don't stop me now.
If you wanna have a good time, just give me